Unitarian Universalist Association of Congregations. And we are guided and inspired by its values and principles. Those values and principles move us to remember that we in Northampton inhabit unceded land of the Pecumtuck and Nipmuc peoples. Our values and principles remind us to acknowledge our responsibilities to face the legacies of dispossession and systemic racism that are a part of our collective history, even as we affirm and celebrate the legacies that inspire us. We are here to support and celebrate one another and to renew ourselves with hope and gratitude and new resolve. It's wonderful to see you all here who volunteer in our volunteering in the Great Hall and all of you online. If you are new or returning after a time away, please feel free to fill out a welcome card, which you will find in the chat. Doing this allows us to put you on our email list, contact list. We ask everyone online to keep your videos off except during the greeting in order to help the technology work as smoothly as possible. There will be a Zoom social hour as well after the service. And we will now begin our service.
Good morning. I'm Sarah Metcalf. I'm a member of the Climate Action Group. Starting here, what do you want to remember? How sunlight creeps along a shining floor? What scent of old wood hovers? What softened sound from outside fills the air? Will you ever bring a better gift for the world than the breathing respect that you carry wherever you go right now? Are you waiting for time to show you some better thoughts? When you turn around, starting here, lift this new glimpse that you found. Carry into evening all that you want from this day. This interval you spent reading or hearing this, keep it for life. What can anyone give you greater than now, starting here, right in this room, when you turn around? I invite everyone to rise in body or spirit for our chalice lighting. We light our chalice as a beacon of hope, a sign of our quest for truth and meaning. We light our chalice as a beacon of love in celebration of the life we share together.
Hi. This story is called We Are Water Protectors, and it is by Carol Lindstrom, a Native American from the Ojibwe tribe of the Great Plains. Right now, Native Americans are engaged in a great battle, and we Unitarians are their allies. The biggest oil companies have built a huge black pipeline from North Dakota through South Dakota to Southern Illinois. It's called the Dakota Access Pipeline, and it carries crude oil for 1,200 miles under many lakes and streams in Ojibwe land. And it also runs under the Missouri and the Mississippi rivers. The pipeline threatens millions of people's water supply, and the oil which it carries will endanger our planet when it adds to global warming. The Ojibwe people are leading the struggle against this oil pipeline, and they call the pipeline the Black Snake. This is the story of how the Ojibwe make themselves strong today to fight a terrible enemy, and how they love and honor our Earth. We are water protectors. Water is the first medicine, Nokomis told me. It nourished us inside our mother's body as it nourishes us here on Mother Earth. Water is sacred, she said. We stand with our songs and our drums, we are still here. The river's rhythm runs through my veins, runs through my people's veins. My people talk of a black snake that will destroy the land, spoil the water, poison plants and animals, wreck everything in its path. When my people first spoke of the black snake, they foretold that it wouldn't come for many, many years. Now the black snake is here. Its venom burns the land, courses through the water, making it unfit to drink. Take courage. I must keep the black snake away from my village's water. I must rally my people together to stand for the water, to stand for the land, to stand as one against the black snake. We fight for those who cannot fight for themselves, the winged ones, the crawling ones, the four-legged, the two-legged, the plants, trees, rivers, and lakes, the earth. We are all related. We stand with our songs and our drums. We are still here. We are stewards of the earth. Our spirits have not been broken. We are water protectors. We stand.
Thank you. And now it's time for us to greet one another. You're invited to turn on your videos and wave and say hello in the chat. It's helpful to switch to gallery view. If anyone is new or newish and would like to, please say hello and tell us where you're from. Yes. Everybody's quiet this morning. No chatting yet.
How many people are here, Jim?
79.
Ooh, very good.
That's great. Awesome. Jane from Northampton hadn't been here for a while. Hi, Jane. Teresa Amabile says, hope everybody is warm today. Nancy Cheevers says, good morning from Leeds. Caitlin Carmody, hi everyone, my name is Caitlin and I live in East Hampton. I started attending services in November and I am so grateful for this community. Well, we're glad to have you. Sam Crowley, hi, I am new. I am currently living in South Hadley. You've been joining over the last month. You enjoy being here. Thanks for being here yourself. Rich King, greetings from a very snowy Maynard. Wow. Gail Herman, it's cold outside but warm with USNF. Janet Clark from Leeds, pretty new. Glad to be here. Glad to have you. Julie Chandler, happy almost February to all. Annie Kesserer, hello, currently in a residential treatment facility, so nice to tune in and see the community here. It's making my day. We're glad you're with us, Anna. Craig Machado, I am glad to be here this morning. Just started attending recently. Welcome, Craig. Megan Coleman from Hudson, home of snow. Joanne Nahalski, good morning. I am new. I live in Northampton. Welcome, Joanne. Paula and Wally, two of the legions. Great to have you. Molly, I encourage everyone, especially new folks, to attend the breakout room social hour after the service. Thanks for that reminder, Molly. Okay, it has been great to see everybody. Please remember to turn off your videos. It's time for everyone going to religious education activities to leave us. Please join in singing them out.
Hi, I'm Bill Diamond from the Climate Action Group. This is the Social Justice Minute. I am so glad we are what Reverend William Barber calls a fusion coalition. For example, people in the USNF racial justice groups are writing letters about the climate, and members of the Climate Action Group are participating in the society's racial justice activities. People in the Climate Action Group and racial justice groups are writing postcards for USNF The Vote and vice versa. The point is, we're together in all of these interrelated struggles. We are drowning in non-recyclable packaging. Individuals, municipalities, and the Commonwealth pay for this. There are massive environmental costs, including greenhouse gases and plastics in the ocean. Dumps and incinerators are often cited in environmental justice communities. Today's action is about supporting extended producer responsibility for packaging. Bills, including these three that you see here, shift responsibility and costs for the safe collection, recycling, and recovery of packaging to manufacturers. So again, I would ask you to do just one thing. Right now I'm going into the chat. Just a second. I have to stop the share for a sec. Right now, please click this link in the chat, this short link. After the service is over, fill out the simple form to individually email the Senate and House leadership, heads of the environment, natural resources, and agriculture community, and Joe Comerford and Lindsay Sabadosa all at once. You just fill it out once, and then you send emails to all of them. Then enjoy the beautiful day after snow. Thank you. Please remember, click the link in the chat right now.
Our generosity makes everything we do possible, and it helps us support organizations and movements in the greater community. Half of the proceeds of each week's offerings support the Society's operating budget, and half are shared outside our walls. You can mail in a check or donate online. The link is in the chat. You may also put cash or a check in the offering plate here. Well, nobody's here to put offerings in the chancel, unfortunately, this morning. Thank you, and now we'll listen to our offertory music.
Thich Nhat Hanh, the revered Buddhist teacher and peace activist, died on January 22nd at the age of 95. His funeral was yesterday. Today's meditation was taken from his translation of one of the most important Buddhist texts, the Metta Sutta. Metta means loving kindness in Pali, the language of the early Buddhist scriptures, and this is one of the earliest. Tradition holds that the Buddha taught this meditation to help his disciples overcome fear. Those who wish to attain peace should practice being upright, humble, and capable of loving speech. They will know how to live simply and happily, with senses calmed, without being covetous and carried away by the emotions of the majority. Let them not do anything that will be disapproved of by the wise ones. This is how they should contemplate. May everyone be happy and safe, and may their hearts be filled with joy. May all loving beings live in security and peace, beings who are frail or strong, tall or short, big or small, visible or not visible, near or far away, already born or yet to be born. May all of them dwell in perfect tranquility. Let no one do harm to anyone. Let no one put the life of anyone in danger. Let no one, out of anger or ill will, wish anyone any harm. Just as a mother loves and protects her only child at the risk of her own life, so we should cultivate boundless love to offer to all beings in the entire cosmos. Let our boundless love pervade the whole universe, above, below, and across. Our love will know no obstacles. Our heart will be absolutely free from hatred and enmity. Whether standing or walking, sitting or lying, as long as we are awake, we should maintain this mindfulness of love in our own heart. This is the noblest way of living. We will be silent together.
Who made the salty soup?
Thank you, Ellen. Beautiful song. This reading is a poem by Mary Oliver on traveling to beautiful places. Every day, I'm still looking for God, and I'm still finding him everywhere, in the dust, in the flower beds, certainly in the oceans, in the islands that lie in the distance, continents of ice, countries of sand, each with its own set of creatures, and God, by whatever name. How perfect to be aboard a ship with maybe 100 years and still in my pocket. But it's late for all of us, and in truth, the only ship there is the ship we are all still on, burning the world as we go. We'll now join in singing hymn number 83, Winds Be Still. In the recent Adam McKay film, Don't Look Up, a comet on a collision course with Earth stands in for the climate emergency. Horrified scientists, who understand that the impact will extinguish the human race, try desperately to alert the government and the public. But the government is cynical and corrupt, the media churn everything into entertainment, and the message falls on deaf ears. The film takes its title from a disinformation campaign launched by the US president's party when the comet becomes visible. Look up, the scientists shout, hoping it can be deflected. But not looking up, as insane and absurd a response as that is, becomes a political mantra. As many have noted, it's hard to make a political satire these days when we're living in one. There are many ways in which the comet analogy doesn't really work. The comet is random, wildly unlikely, and sudden, like a bomb hurled at us from out of nowhere. Unlike global warming, we haven't caused it, and it hasn't crept up on us by fractions of degrees over centuries. Unlike the fossil fuel economy, it hasn't powered and poisoned the world. Unlike climate disruption, it doesn't first threaten the lives of the poor. But the movie isn't really about climate change itself. If it were, its title would have to be Don't Look Anywhere. A brief update for those who, like me, sometimes read headlines and can't bear to read further. 2021 was one of the 7 warmest years on record. All 7 have taken place since 2015. In the US, we lost 7.13 million more acres of forest to fire. More than 600 people perished in a heat wave in the Pacific Northwest. 2 separate swarms of tornadoes tore across the Midwest in December, reducing towns to matchsticks. 8 named hurricanes made landfall. Ida was particularly severe, killing 96. 4 in 10 Americans live in a county that was struck by some form of climate-related extreme weather this past year, to the tune of $145 billion worth of damage to property. Don't look abroad. Floods raged through Germany, Belgium, China, British Columbia. Powerful typhoons hit India, the Maldives, the Philippines. Record-breaking temperatures around the world reached that of a medium rare steak. Don't look, especially, at the tipping points climatologists have identified as points of no return. They are rapidly worsening. 2 in particular stand out: the threat to the Thwaites Glacier in Antarctica, posed by the weakening of its ice shelf, whose melting will raise sea levels by 10 feet worldwide, inundating every coastal city on Earth, and the thawing of Siberia's vast permafrost, which sequesters 1.5 trillion tons of carbon, twice as much as is currently held in Earth's atmosphere. These warming processes are self-perpetuating. They'll continue even if we succeed in drastically lowering atmospheric CO2. And we're not on course to do that. Instead, we're on course for self-extinction or something very close to it. The nations of COP26 failed to create binding commitments to meet this existential emergency. The United States Congress is not expected to pass meaningful climate legislation. No one wants to believe any of this is really happening. This is the real subject of Don't Look Up, of course: denial. In the movie's absurd, painful mirror, we see reflected all our structural inertia and its component failures of imagination, disorganization, egotism, narcissism, and greed. But denial has many faces, and recently I was confronted with my own. About a month ago, Janet Bush emailed me asking for a title for this service, and I was quite startled. What service? I'd completely forgotten volunteering to speak. How could I have done that? I mean, I'm getting older, but generally I feel I still possess a full set of marbles. On reflection, however, it made sense. Over the 10 years or so that I've been offering these brief in-house reflections on climate change, they've gotten harder and harder to write. Having to think deeply on this subject hurts. Peter Kalmus, a NASA climate scientist, is all over Twitter with his grief and despair. Dar Jamail, one of the best journalists on this subject, whose work I've often quoted, has quit writing his columns for Truth Out to preserve his mental health. Their misery has plenty of company. The Lancet has posted a preprint of a survey of 10,000 young people aged 16 to 25 from 10 countries, chosen to reflect populations from the global North and South, representing a range of cultures, incomes, climates, climate vulnerabilities, and exposure to climate-related events. Respondents were asked about their feelings. Overall, 83% said we have failed to care for our planet. 75% said the future is frightening. 56% said humanity is doomed. 55% feared that what they most value will be destroyed. 39% said they were hesitant to have children. Climate dysphoria is, of course, not unique to the young. There is a whole body of psychological research and analysis devoted to it now, with its own taxonomy, some of it quite beautiful. There's solastalgia, homesickness for places that our changing climate has ruined or erased. Eco-anxiety, a generalized sense of impending environmental doom. Climate grief, an acute mourning for the world, as one would mourn a loved one's death. The Finnish even have words for particular losses. I don't pretend to know how to pronounce these. Lumiadistus, anxiety over diminished snowfall, and talvisuru, grief for the loss of deep winter. People who live closer to nature are thought to have these feelings more strongly, or perhaps simply to understand their source more clearly. But I believe that as mammals, every one of us can sense in every cell how the balance of the world is broken. We suffer it as an injury, and an omnipresent foreboding and disorientation is the deep, droning background music of our lives. I thought of this when I read Michelle Goldman's recent New York Times column entitled "The Mental Health Toll of Trump-Era Politics." She quotes a study that says 90% of registered voters believe there's a mental health crisis in the United States attributable to our toxic political climate. Quote, "The crisis expresses itself in all sorts of ways, in rising rates of youth suicide, record overdoses, random acts of street violence, months-long waiting lists for children's therapists, mask meltdowns, QAnon." But who's to say all of this isn't part of how we're responding to environmental collapse? Even COVID-19 isn't a separate phenomenon. It's a zoonotic disease with its roots in habitat loss. So I have this to say about denial, not the structural denial of sclerotic institutions, but the kind we experience as individuals. I understand these points are paradoxical. One, it's impossible. We know what we know. Two, it's reflexive. What we can't assimilate, what we can't bear, we automatically push away. Three, it's necessary. I was thinking back on a climate action meeting I was at a couple of years ago in Marty Nathan's living room. Normally, we were all business, but this particular day we were talking about our discouragement. I talked about mine. Marty, whose tireless determination cheered and inspired every activist in the Pioneer Valley, told me crisply to take antidepressants, as she did, and pick up the next task and keep going. Dar Jamail, in an interview, was asked how he manages his climate grief. He said that he limits his intake of news, just enough to know what's going on, not more. And when he's feeling particularly terrible, he goes outside to climb a mountain or just lean against a tree. That every morning he asks himself, what can I do today that will serve the planet? What can I do that will serve other people? Making these efforts, they were saying, is really the only therapy available to us and an obdurate source of meaning, even as our chances of turning the tides of history dwindle. And in order to make these efforts, we have to use what sustains us and discard what does not. You could call this denial, and I think that would be accurate, but you could also call it courage. I am sustained by this congregation. A couple of weeks ago, when Bill Diamond asked everyone here to please write letters in support of the Green Future Act, more than 80 people followed through. I can't tell you what a shot in the arm that was for all of us in the Climate Action Group. You know, our legislators tell us that this level of constituent pressure is effective, and it's so much better to work as a group than in isolation. All the effort our congregation has put into USNF the Vote and all the other initiatives Bill mentioned today are more examples of how we cheer each other on, or to borrow the ringing words of Howard Thurman that Janet put before us recently, how we keep fresh before us the moments of our high resolve. We depend on such moments. William Stafford's poem from our opening words was about inhabiting the present, the immediate, not a future in which hopes are either dashed or realized. He asked, "Will you ever bring a better gift for the world than the breathing respect that you carry wherever you go?" I think the answer is no. And for evidence of this, at least, we can look anywhere. Please join in singing our final hymn, which is number 27, "I Am That Great and Fiery Force." Closing words. Our closing words are a small fragment from the poem "Under One Small Star" by Wisława Szymborska. My apologies to the felled tree for the table's four legs. My apologies to great questions for small answers. Thank you.
dance like it was 1999. My dreams were wild. The promise of this new world would be mine. Now I am throwing off the carelessness of you. Listen to an inconvenient truth, 'cause I need to move, I need to wake up, I need to change, I need to shake up, I need to speak out, something's gotta break up. I've been asleep and I need to break up. I've been asleep and I need to wake up now. I want to change. I need to shake up. I need to speak out. Oh, something's got to break up. I've been